My father died of a stroke. I had a difficult divorce. The father of my four sons and I split up. I got fired. My businesses lost thousands and thousands of euros. I hit the wall. It was a lousy year. The ground under my feet disappeared and I hit rock bottom. It was a really lousy year. Everything looked good on the outside, but inside I was like a broken mosaic. I did not know how to survive. I was devastated. For the first time in my life, I understood why people come to a point of complete hopelessness. They simply don't see any solution. I was in survival mode. I had tried different ways to turn my life around, but I just slipped back into my old negative thinking patterns. I understood I couldn't do it on my own. So how did I turn my life around? I will get back to that in a moment. I didn't have any tools to take control of my thinking because my thoughts had hijacked me. The frontal cortex is the part of our brain where logical and strategic thinking is located. When we are under extreme stress, such as when fight or flight mode response is activated, this part may shut down, which we sometimes is called an amygdala hijacking. Many people don't take action until they have had to go through a big crisis or a trauma, a diagnosis or a loss of a loved one. But why wait for something like that to happen before we take control of our thinking? English is not my first language, so I had to learn English to get to the teachers I wanted in my life and also be able to reach my word, the word will my discovery. I'm not an expert in grammar. Oops, that's not grammar. That's my children's grandma. Oops, I meant English grammar. By the way, my grandma also died during that period. It was a really lousy year. But all of this didn't happen to me for no reason. At that time, I couldn't see it, but now I understand the greater purpose. It needed to happen for me so I could find the tools to share with you today and with the world. My intuition led me on a path to study our mind. So I did, in practice and at the university. I became a mind expert, a mind trainer, and I also studied neuro-linguistic programming and became an NLP master practitioner and trainer, an advanced professional hypnotist, and coach of the subconscious mind. I don't know how it happened, but suddenly I knew there was more to life than I was currently experiencing. I knew I had found a way forward. When you come up with a new formula or a new recipe, you don't invent the ingredients. You combine existing ingredients in a different way. And as a result, you get a new dish. And that was exactly what I did. I need to ask you three questions. Number one, have you ever heard about repetition? Number two, have you ever heard about repetition? And number three, have you ever heard about repetition? When you learned how to ride a bicycle, did you manage it straight away? No, you probably needed to practice it over and over again until you could do it unconsciously, even thinking about it. Now you just do it. You have programmed your subconscious mind. The result is the same every time, whether you use a proven formula or a blueprint, a system or principles. You know what you will get based on the formula. If you follow the cookbook recipe for meatballs, you will get meatballs, not lentil soup, right? Surprised? No. If you go to the gym and follow your PT's instructions on how to build muscles, you will get muscles, right? But you don't expect results overnight, do you? They come over time. Be kind to yourself and have patience. But you have to stick to the system. You have to go there and stay consistent. It's exactly the same way with your thinking. In order to create a new habit, we have to repeat the action. So it happens automatically, just like learning how to ride a bike. The same applies to all thoughts, negative, limited, or empowering. So it's very important to be aware of our thinking, because our thinking is affecting our emotions. The emotions' sole function is to help us, keep us safe and secure. But they are not always pleasant, but they are here to protect us. We can't control them. It happens in a split second. But what we can take control over is how we react. So we can either choose to stay calm or to get angry or something else. I have created my own model, UNA, where you observe, notice and accept the thoughts, not react, not value, not judge. It's not the easiest thing to do, I know, but with practice, you learn to be in charge only by observing, like clouds in the sky. But we need to practice. So we do it unconsciously, by autopilot. Our reaction is a program we are running. So if we want to react in another way, we need to reprogram our behavior. There are several things you can do to change your thinking or how you feel. You can either go through your body or through your mind, because body and mind are combined. After polishing my recipe, I ended up with several ingredients which I use every day. There are 5 ingredients from my method that I want to share with you today. Who amongst you can breathe? Most of you are doing it right now, I hope. Yes, good. Lehrer says in his research that through breathing and mental focus, you affect your autonomic nervous system in a positive way. But it depends how you breathe. Even breathing needs to be practiced. The second ingredient is gratefulness. There are 1,200 reasons why you feel good when you have feelings of gratitude. It's all due to a chemical reaction, or 1,200 of them is being released. According to Dr. Joe Dispenza, we see more brain coherence and heart coherence when practicing gratitude. And evidence shows that even our immune system improves. The mental process is to reprogram your subconscious mind to feel good only by thinking. The third ingredient in my method is to be aware of our inner hypnotist, our self-talk, you know, the voice in our head. When I'm at the golf course with my son Felix, he sometimes says, "I don't want to end up in the bunker." By saying that, his subconscious mind directly creates an image of the bunker, hitting the bunker. And guess where he ended up? When we talked about it and changed his word to, "I want to reach the green in a good spot," then he did. Say what you want to see, because your subconscious mind creates an image of what you say. Be aware of your self-talk. What you are saying to yourself is what you are programming yourself with. When you make a mistake and say, "Oh, I'm so stupid, people will laugh at me," all this is unconscious self-talk that affects your subconscious mind. So change your self-talk to a pep talk. You can say instead, "I can do it. Yes, it's okay. Believe in yourself." Use conscious self-talk to reprogram your subconscious mind with positive affirmations, or even called positive suggestions. By repetition, you program your subconscious mind into belief. In other words, by repeating positive affirmations or suggestions, they will turn into truths. I still use one. I haven't changed since I first started. It's important to repeat every single word exactly the same way every time. I have borrowed mine from Charles Hanel. "I'm whole, perfect, strong, powerful, loving, harmonious, and happy. When I first started to use that affirmation, I didn't feel anything but silly. But after a while, I started to believe in the words. I also use a short one when I need all is well. The fourth ingredient is to have a clear goal. Daily habits will prime your brain. Start your day with a clear intention, because where your attention goes, energy flows. You are no longer in the past, you are now creating a future, a new future, so you can reprogram subconscious mind with new memories. You have directed the autopilot to the target. This is not a bite and a swallow, and then you're done. You don't breathe once either, do you? And then you're done. No, this is a process. I'm telling you, this is a process of reprogramming, redesigning, rewiring, reconditioning. It's a process of awareness. That is the work your brain has to do, over and over again, by repetition. Rewiring your brain results from two things in neuroplasticity. New neurons, the growth of new neurons, and new connections between the neurons. Through visualization, you can turn an abstract hope into a picture that not only inspires you, but also guides you. According to a study called The Future of Memory, Remembering, Imagining, and the Brain in NCBI, the human brain can't always distinguish between a memory and a vision of the future. So the last ingredient I want to talk about today is very juicy. Actually, the secret sauce. There are five major types of brainwave patterns that we can measure by EEG, rated from lower activity to from higher to lower in our brain. And the beta waves is seen when we are awake in an alert consciousness. Alpha waves are when we are calm and relaxed, but still awake. Theta waves are in between relaxed and deep sleep. You know, the state when light sleep occur, or hypnosis and trance. And then the delta waves appear in deep sleep. And the difference between subconscious mind and conscious mind is the analytical mind, the logical mind. Your conscious mind is the reasoning mind. And your subconscious mind just accepts what you consciously believe. During meditation, our brain waves change. The practice is to slow them down, because we go into an alternative state of consciousness, into a state of trance. Then we go beyond the analytical mind, and the sensory changes in the brain can occur. And there are countless of experiments on people when in trance, where the subconscious mind will accept suggestions. The subconscious mind does not argue with the conscious mind, it just accepts. That's worth remembering. Many of the most creative scientists, composers in history have realized the true importance of the subconscious mind. Edison, Einstein, Beethoven, and many, many others have used the subconscious mind to give them the know-how to bring about their incredible achievements. I first started to practice meditation in a temple in Thailand. After my first visit there, the founder of the temple, the monk and my teacher, called me. Like a miracle, he invited me to come and stay with them, the scorpions, the poisonous snakes, and the monks, to practice meditation. Okay, not to practice with the snakes and scorpions, but with the monks. Despite the fact they were not allowed to take any new people to the temple, they stayed and asked me to stay there because he said my karma was so good. That was unique and challenging at the same time, as we meditated from 3 o'clock a.m. to 9 o'clock p.m. But most of all, it was the perfect place for me to be at that time. Since then, I have been practiced meditation every day. And meditation is the perfect practice. It's a key to transformation. It works on the deep level of your psyche, in your subconscious mind. So how to stay calm in adversity? It's normal to react, but the trick is to bounce back. And that's the skill you can learn. When you have learned to self-regulate, you can get an overall resilience to your circumstances in life, to manage what goes around us. So this is my message. Where you are no longer dependent on the outer world, then you control your reality. And this is not only self-leadership, it's self-mastery. And one more thing, don't work hard. It's a myth that you have to struggle and strain and hard work to get results. I'm not saying you don't need to work at all or make any sacrifices. The key is to only make sacrifices that will make you feel good within. Those sacrifices must be in alignment with what your heart wants. Do the things you love to do. Live your passion. Live your life purpose. Listen to your soul. You know, when you do what you love to do, when you forgot time and space and just do, forget to eat and drink, then you are in a state of flow. And that's where the magic happens. And everything just falls into place. I am no longer living in survival mode. I'm living my true nature from the power within, free to be the real me. I'm here to share my techniques so you can tap into your infinite power, the incredible power, your subconscious mind. Learn how to use this hidden power. Have a better life, and that will also lead to a better world. As Oprah Winfrey says, the more you praise and celebrate your life, the more there is in life to celebrate. This year, my method have helped not only me, but hundreds of customers. This year, I became a global speaker. This year, I was also nominated for the Entrepreneur of the Year Award by the International Organization Global Women. This year, my real estate company had finally completed our new retreat. This year, people from mainland Finland discovered our beautiful island Åland in the Baltic Sea, and our summer house was fully booked for rentals. This year, I spent more time than ever with my youngest son, Felix. He was doing his schoolwork from home, and I was working from home. He has also been my assistant, my support, my manager. He's so brilliant, doing excellent work. And this year, I can call myself an author of a book. This year, the stores in our shopping mall had more local customers than ever before. This year, I'm standing here giving you a TEDx talk. This year, my wish and hope for each and every one of you to have a great year, this year and every year. And remember, don't forget to breathe. Thank you.